Vemos el conteo, una, dos palmaditas, no se rinde todavía Fishman. La acción continúa con mi compañero Adolfo Pérez.
Gracias, Ernesto. Bueno, aquí estamos viendo nuevamente el perro aguayo poniendo de plancha al Fishman. Ahí va a subirse a la cuerda superior el perro aguayo para caerle esas 240 libras en la humanidad. ¡Ay!
Welcome to America's only TV wrestling magazine, Pro Wrestling This Week. I'm Joe Fedeseno.
And I'm Gordon Solie. And during the next hour, we're going to be seeing a Pacific Northwest Heavyweight Championship match, a world-class tag team title match, an international match featuring some great Mexican competitors. The Alabama Heavyweight Championship goes on the line, a special Pro Wrestling Illustrated report with Captain Lou Albano, and much, much more. But some big things going on.
That's right, Gordon. Before we get started, you know, one of the big things that happened this week took place in the Continental area. You're very familiar with it. It included 981 pounds, and we're not talking about a new wrestler.
No, we're not, but we are talking about a man who I think is deemed or is going to be perhaps the Rookie of the Year. He just established a 19th world record. Referring, of course, to Doug Furness, former fullback at the University of Tennessee, who at the Seniors Powerlifting Championships in Minneapolis, Minnesota, broke his 19th world record with a 981-pound lift.
That's an amazing lift. Let's take a look at just how he did it.
Okay, this is a third attempt here. It's 981. I made two successful attempts at 920 and 953. And right now I'm getting ready to go to the bar again, trying to get my mind right. Things were a little hard up there. It was a little weight just seemed a little heavier than usual.
This is 981 pounds.
981.
Has anybody else lifted that much?
No, not in the 75s. I got the world record at 985. This is I broke the total record this day, and I had to work for it. It was a little harder than I thought it would be.
That is absolutely phenomenal.
Well, as you can see, it took four men to lift that weight. It took Doug Furness to do a world record squat with it. Quite an impressive weight lift by young Doug Furness. Now, also in Alabama, in the Continental area this week, an Alabama heavyweight title match. The champion, the Bullet, puts the title on the line against Jonathan Boyd, and it's quite a nasty match.
And it's the Bullet trying to regain his feet. Now the Bullet battling his way back to his feet. Bullet showing great second effort here. Bobby D checking him carefully. And the Bullet is all the way back on his feet. And the Bullet scores. Right hand to the midsection. Boyd hanging on with that claw. The Bullet finally breaks free. And Jonathan Boyd picking up that strange chant that he has. The Bullet catches him outside the ring. A good old American right hand haymaker, and then he goes with a sleeper hold. The Bullet has the sleeper hold on Jonathan Boyd. The Bullet is putting... Ah, wait a minute. Mike Golden in there. The referee has called for the bell. The referee has called for the bell, and the Bullet is wreaking havoc. Now here comes Dr. Tom Pritchard. They've got the Bullet trapped. They've got the Bullet in a lot of trouble now as they're all three on him at one time. The referee has been knocked to one side, and now Scott Armstrong trying to battle his way into the ring. Wait a minute, who's there? Wait a second, who have we got here? Brother, you talked about a Rambo kind of character. We've got one here. And he is clearing the ring. Mike Golden catches it again. got over on that time, and beautiful drop kick. Another drop kick. And wait a second. Wait a second. That's Steve Armstrong. Steve Armstrong has just hit the ring. Steve and Scott Armstrong, and they caught him with a super kick. He caught him with a super kick. And wait a second here. They have got Pritchard stretched out. And so the Bullet has maintained his Alabama heavyweight championship by getting Pritchard out of the ring. Steve and Scott Armstrong coming to the aid of the Bullet.
Monster Ripper punishing the in part of the leg of Wendy.
Pro Wrestling This Week continues now as we take a look at the World Wrestling Federation and the Million Dollar Man, Ted DiBiase. He hasn't been doing much wrestling, but he's been throwing out $100 bills to some very, very pleased spectators. And Joe Pedicino had an opportunity for an exclusive interview with Jesse the Body Ventura. Let's go to that interview.
I've got you. I think anybody who had a chance to talk to Jesse Ventura in front of all these fans would want to know this question.
What's that?
Why can't you get along with Vince McMahon and Bruno Sammartino?
Because Vince McMahon and Bruno Sammartino are the most biased announcers that have ever been behind a mic, in my opinion. I mean, it's obvious when they come out, they have a favorite. If their favorite gets the worst end of the stick, they have excuses. You never hear Jesse the Body Ventura play favorites out there. I call it down the line. I tell it like it is. And you never see me with a personal favorite coming out and showing that type of favoritism on the mic.
Well, I will admit that by adding Jesse the Body into the mix on the Superstars of Wrestling program, it does make it the most interesting wrestling program around. I'll say that.
Well, I'll say this. You know, I've received thousands of cards and letters that have told me, Jesse, do it all yourself. Get rid of Bruno and McMahon.
Well, obviously, Ventura has his own reasons for why he says he can't get along with Vince McMahon Jr., Joe.
Yes, he certainly is outspoken. Right now, we're going to go to Puerto Rico, and we're going to see a mixed tag team match. Ladies and men wrestling one another. On one team, it's the Invader number 3 and Wendy Richter as they go up against the Assassin and Big Monster Ripper.
Look out! She's trying to drop the leg on the throat of Wendy. Wendy was able to move out of the way. And Big Monster Ripper, she's upset. Now she has to look at inside the ring at the new women's ladies champion of the World Wrestling Council. And besides that, she's competing in the ring and the fans are all behind Wendy and the Invader 3. For those fans keeping a record on your superstars, Wendy was two times the world's ladies champion of the WWF World Wrestling Federation. She's also recognized by the National Wrestling Federation as the Women's Ladies World's Champion. And as you have heard, she is the new World Wrestling Council Ladies Champion of the World. A tremendous lady in action right now. As we see the Canadian Monster Ripper punishing the in part of the leg of Wendy. Monster Ripper, the Canadian powerful woman. She is one of the biggest stars in the Orient, especially in Japan. Monster Ripper, one of the strongest ladies in professional wrestling. Now the men are in action. Watch this move. Swinging neck breaker. He hooks the leg, but not quite, to cover the Invader 3. And the Assassin 1 roughing it up. Here comes Invader. Invader fighting back. Forearm shot. Assassin 1 chopping away. Invader 3 connects well right to the chin area. The fans love it. Wendy also trying to get things moving here. And now the beta three hooks the neck. Watch this dangerous maneuver. He's got him covered. You talking about impressive winning moves. There is one. And the fans love it. The winners of this match, the world's ladies champion of the World Wrestling Council, one director, and the World Wrestling Council's junior heavyweight champion named Vader 3.
So from Puerto Rico, let's move on now to the Big Apple in the offices of Pro Wrestling Illustrated as we listen to senior editor Bill Apter bring us the most hated wrestlers in the United States, the Florida top 10, and then some interesting comments from the captain himself, Lou Albano. Bill?
For Pro Wrestling Illustrated magazine, I'm senior editor Bill Apter. Today, find out who's the top 10 on the most hated list and also ratings for Florida. And a special interview with the captain, Lou Albano. Right now, the top 10 on the most hated list. And now, ratings from Florida. Well, exactly. Hello, I'm back with Captain Lou Albano. First of all, Captain, big question. Been watching wrestling all over the tube, and Captain has been around.
Well, first of all, it's an honor for me coming back here. Bill, just lay dead for a minute, and I'll tell you what I'm talking about. I was here before you presented me with the manager of the year, and I felt very proud about that.
Thank you, Captain.
Captain's been involved now with a show called Hollywood Squares.
Right.
I'll be going out to do that. I'm also doing a new show called Truth and Consequences. I've also got a movie out on home video now with Danny DeVito and Joe Piscopo called Wise Guys. And we've also got a new one coming out with Abdel Casey, with Ric Flair, with Bruno Sammartino, with several other wrestlers, Rowdy Roddy Piper and Captain Lou Albano, and it's called Body Slam. Should be coming out the end of August, dedicating the premiere opening to multiple sclerosis.
Okay, now, Captain, you have not been... Something wrong?
Go right ahead. Keep
okay. You haven't been around the wrestling scene in a couple of months now, and there are a lot of new managers coming around. We got a letter from a manager in the AWA, Paul Dangerously, who says he feels that he is taking the place of Captain Lou Albano.
Now, just a minute now. Just a minute, Bill. Keep it quiet for 1 minute. He may be taking a place or think he's taking a place. The man, I believe, has got the brain of a dehydrated BB. If they put his brain in a parakeet, zing and fly backwards. I'm going to admit this man is a talent. I'm going to admit this man knows his stuff. He knows his wrestling well. He films in entirety. I know that. He knows that. You know that. They know that. But I'm going to tell you something, Paul Dangerously. You better be prepared to back up those words. You think you're better than Lou Albano? Well, come out and prove it. You got a whole bunch of managers.
Captain,
they all
Captain,
get him in here. Captain, I'll debate with him. I'll show him how good he is.
Fine. He's already agreed that he'd come here next week for his debate.
Bring it on.
Is that all right with you?
I told you the man's got the bread of the hydrated BB. He put his bread in the parakeet.
We'll see you next week.
Sing, fly back.
Pro Wrestling
get him here. I'm ready, brother.
Captain Lou Albano.
Get him here.
Yes, sir, Captain.
Hey, bring him out. I'm ready, brother. Bring him out.
Well, Gordon, Lou's certainly a little bit excited there about people like Paul Dangerously. We have a confrontation set up right here next week between those two.
Well, Lou Albano is salty, and speaking of salty, we had a delightful time at the Dish of Salt with Captain Lou, Joe Pedicino, and others, including Bill Apter this past week. We'll be back with more action on pro wrestling this week right after we pause for these words.
Damien is hurt.
He's just dazed. He doesn't seem to know where he is.
Look at this.
Pro Wrestling This Week now takes a look at a cage match that took place in the NWF, Gordon, in Bricktown, New Jersey.
Rage in a Cage is what it was called, and it pits Bruiser Brody and Jules Strongbow up against the combination of DC Drake and Damien Kane. Now, the whole purpose here is you must get out of the cage to win the match. Watch what happens.
Damien is hurt.
He's just dazed. He doesn't seem to know where he is.
Look at this. Brody has got one foot on the floor. He has 1 foot on the floor. He continues to pound on the head of DC Drake. The Mad Dog holding on for dear life. Strongbow. A shot to the head of Damien Kane. Mad Dog is now stretching the groin area of Bruiser Brody.
Joel Strombo trying to get
Strombo
over the top.
Over the top on this side of the ring.
He's trying to anyway. Looks like...
They're grabbing a hold of him now. Damian's got him.
Oh.
Down goes Strombo.
Oh, he took a shot.
Oh, these guys must all be totally out of it. Brody. Oh, no. Oh,
oh my.
Brody. An unbelievable shot to Brody. Strongbow and Brody in trouble now. And Mad Dog is trying to take a casual stroll outside of the ring once again.
It's almost down. Look at him. Brody gets
Brody him. Got him. Grabs a hold of him. Mad Dog thought he had it made.
Yeah, he was a little too casual about that, I think. But
yeah. It seems like he's taking a casual stroll outside the ring area.
Oh, oh, look at that shot.
Damian now bleeding.
Yep. Oh, everybody just except for Bruiser. And now Bruiser's coming out of the...
Brody. Now he's just about out of the ring.
Losing his balance. He's trying to get up. Oh, look at that.
Oh, once again, everybody's on their feet. The capacity crowd is screaming here.
Look at this. He's got a handful of hair.
Yeah.
Trying to get him back into...
Look at this.
Oh, look at that. That's incredible action here. This National Wrestling Federation action is just incredible. Now they're all back inside the ring again.
Bruiser now really looks like he's just about had it.
So all the wrestlers looked,
all had it. Really, really out of it. Strongbow taking a beating from Damian Kane right now. He's just dead on his feet right now, as you can see. But not that dead. When that adrenaline is a strange thing.
Look at this! Oh my! They're both
Strombo
oh,
is out of the ring. Strombo is out of the ring.
Strombo, I think
they win.
Out.
They win.
Yeah, Strombo came out, I believe.
The winners: Bruiser Brody, Chief Jules Strombo.
That's right.
On a move that backfired on DC Drake.
That's what happened.
So Bruiser Brody is rammed literally into Strombo, who then goes out of the cage, and his team wins our cage match from the National Wrestling Federation. Now it's the National Wrestling Alliance. The Great American Bashes have been taking place all across the country, and one of the top matches from those bashes, the Freebirds taking on the team of Ivan Koloff and Paul Jones. And we're going to take you to that match right now.
They don't call him the bear for nothing. He will maul you. He'll work you over. He'll roughhouse you in any way he can. Well, Ivan Koloff.
You hear that penalty? That's Michael Hayes right down at ringside. There he is.
There goes Roberts now. He's out of the ring this time, down on the floor. He hit it with a big splash. Now look at Jones going to work on it.
Kicking him. Michael Hayes going to run over, try to get things broken up. Boy, he was right there in a hurry. You know, the advantage, man-wise, number-wise, 3-on-2 Freebirds.
Right.
But they're having trouble still with Paul Jones. Right on the metal fence. And that caught him a good lick.
Koloff is back in. Now Jones. Well, I tell you, Jones knows how to use that ring, too. He uses it for protection some as he comes back into the corner and out again, Tony. But I tell you, you got to hand it to him. That's smarts not to get trapped in a corner that way. Patented move on the part of Ivan Koloff.
And a great double team. You can say what you want to about him. Maybe they don't go by the rules, but as long as he does that and breaks on a five count, it's legal, and it did the damage on Buddy Roberts as Paul Jones held in. Again, Jones comes in with a good situation. Oh, missed the knee!
Koloff had it set up for him, and Jones went high to the air with a knee drop and missed it.
Uh-oh.
Now look at Jones. Trouble now.
Oh, what an elbow.
Boy, when you get that elbow smash with all that weight and power behind it, there it is. You know you've been smashed when that elbow hits you, and it hit him flush. Harry Gordy came high to the air with an elbow smash, Tony, right down on Jones, who was flat on the mat.
The Great American Bash on Tour has had its victims, however. J.J. Dillon is out now with a badly separated shoulder. and Nikita Koloff has an injured neck. Getting back to J.J. Dillon, however, the War Games, the match beyond, which will take place in the grand finale of the Great American Bash in Miami on July 31st at the Orange Bowl, J.J. Dillon has announced he has a man called the War Machine who will be taking his place in the ring. Now, let's move on to the Wild West Wrestling, and we're going to watch Iceman Parsons as he goes up against Ray Evans, and it's our friend Bill Mercer calling the action.
Iceman complaining that Ray Evans pulled his hair. But the big redhead from Waco says no way as he works on the left arm of Iceman King Parsons. Moving into that corner. Watch here. Knee into the midsection. That slows up Ray Evans a bit. Yes, Wild West Wrestling will be on the move. Rather with that slogan, we go west and go Wild West, and we'll be there. And speaking of being there, we'll be at Southport, and that's where Lorimar Productions has their location for films worldwide. The number one show on television. And great, great adventure, excitement, style, grace, beauty, and intrigue. Dallas, J.R. and Company, Lorimar Productions, right in Southport. And the count of two, and Iceman King Parsons, I think, pulled him up that time. Maybe he wants to punish a little bit more, as Iceman had Ray Evans down and looked like an easy count of three. And was Evans, nice move by Evans underneath, and a front butt by Iceman King Parsons. That might just do it. One, two, and three, and the Iceman comes sailing through.
Twist the head of Colas from his shoulders.
Welcome back to Pro Wrestling This Week. Time now to head to Kansas City and Big Ox.
That's right, Big Ox Baker. A veteran of the ring wars, he has a famed and fearsome heart punch. We watch him as he goes up against Steve Estes. And then something interesting comes from the hustler, Rip Rogers.
But he's messed with Brenda Britton, he's messed with me, and he's in trouble now, baby.
There it is, the heart punch of Ox Baker that had put two men away in professional
wrestling. That ought to be illegal.
Literally away, as in killed.
I know you're 6 foot six. I know you're from Cold Camp, Missouri, but don't you mess with me. If you want to match with me, get in there right now and I'll knock you out.
Well, the challenge is down. Ox Baker in the ring, setting that taped fist for the heart punch. Hustler Rip Rogers is headed around the other side of the ring. We're going to try to get a word with Ox Baker here. We're going to try to get a word with Ox Baker here. Hustler Rip Rogers at ringside.
Very, very bad. I want to beat the hell out of him for you people, Kansas.
I tell you, we got a potential confrontation looming here with Hustler Rip Rogers. Rogers at ringside.
Everybody in this building, they know Baker's scared of me. I can beat him up anytime I want to. You people, shut up!
You hear the people, Mr. Rogers. They want to see you get in the ring and wrestle him yourself.
This is not the time, and this is not the place. But Baker, you'll pay for what you did to Brenda.
In a minute. Ox Baker sliding outside the ring.
I'll get him somewhere, somehow, I can promise. I'm going to beat him up somewhere.
There you heard it, the potential.
Well, Rip, it seems like any time, any place, except today, right? Time now to move on to Memphis, Tennessee. We've got a great tag team match here. Bill Dundee and Rocky Johnson in action. They're going to go up against Keith Roberson and a fella who calls himself Rooster Cogburn. Let's see if the Duke is in the ring.
That's Cogburn starting out with Dundee. Rocky finally slipping out of the ring. Rooster took a quick look over his shoulder as he went around circling Billy and saw that Rocky was still there. Woo! Twister missing one. Bill Dundee does not whip across the ring. Back drop. Telling the referee that Dundee was using the tights. Very agile kind of. Dundee whipping him around the ring, shoots him to the corner, and he beats Rocky Johnson's foot. Big tag goes to the Rock. Wow, what a sharp right hand. Rocky can throw those rights, and he doesn't do too bad with that left either. Powerful man, 275. His partner at 205. They make quite a team. They go back a long way together. Robertson. As Rocky spins around into a hammer. Takes him over and down. And Keith wrestles out of Memphis, Tennessee. Keith went to tie up with him, and Rock just danced away to the side.
Shut up!
Robertson with Johnson back on the rope. Rocky flicking that left, followed by a killer right. Tag on Johnson. Referee running Cochran back out. Keith down on the deck. Dundee covers him. One, two, three, and that's going to be it.
The AWA can indeed boast of having one of the greatest Indian wrestlers of all times as part of their organization. I'm referring, of course, to Chief Wahoo McDaniel out of Oklahoma. We're going to watch the Chief in action now as he takes on Mike Tolis, and watch that right hand.
Has the chin lock again on Mike Tolis.
It's obvious wherever your head goes, your body's got to follow, and Tolis is not going to have a head if he keeps squeezing it very hard like this for very long.
Wahoo McDaniel among the AWA stars to be in Great Falls, Montana at the Montana State Fair July 26th. Nick Bockwinkel will be there. Larry Zbyszko will be there. Jimmy Superfly Snuka will be there. Kurt Hennig, Wahoo McDaniel, and you will want to be there. That's the Montana State Fair, Great Falls, July 26th. Mark it down in your calendar now. Wahoo McDaniel with a knee drop. Mike Tolis, 255. Wahoo, 250. A couple of giants in there. Backdrop. A backbreaker. Cover by McDaniel. Tolis is able to kick his way out. At two. McDaniel with a whip. Oh! Cover. It is all over. Wow. He caught Tolis coming off that rope with a judo shot that you could hear from Las Vegas to Reno. And
probably the most wicked Indian chops in wrestling belong to Wahoo McDaniel. It's time now for you to sound off. Bonnie Blackstone is standing by. She has some comments about the Henning Bockwinkel situation and a question about reaching your favorite NWA wrestlers. Bonnie?
Now here's a question. From Marilyn E. watching KDFI, Channel 27 in Dallas, Texas. She wants to know, where is Ted DiBiase? Marilyn, the Million Dollar Man, as he's calling himself now, has shown up in the WWF. Unfortunately, he's reverting to his old ways. It looks like we'll be watching for Ted DiBiase and his chauffeur Virgil in the WWF programs across the country and right here on Pro Wrestling This Week. And Vicky T. of Racine, Wisconsin, watching in Minneapolis, Minnesota on KTMA, Channel 23, comments to us, if you watched the match between Kurt Hennig and Nick Bockwinkel very closely, you'll see Larry Zbyszko hand Kurt Hennig a roll of coins. Officials say that it may not exist, but the fans know better. No one takes down the champ in one punch. No one. Bockwinkel deserves a rematch. That belt belongs around his waist and not around Kurt Hennig's. And William B. of Las Vegas, Nevada, watching on KRLR Channel 21 asks, how do I write the Road Warriors? Well, William, it's simple. Here's the address. Jim Crockett Promotions, 421 Bryan Bend Drive, Charlotte, North Carolina, 28209. Before we say goodbye, let me encourage you to sound off at Pro Wrestling This Week Sound Off, Post Office Box 54556, Atlanta, Georgia 30308. Let us know your Pro Wrestling This Week station. I'm Bonnie Blackstone.
His right hand has really got to be hurting him right now. Here he comes again, right across the forehead of Rip Oliver. And
our Pro Wrestling This Week cameras move now to the Universal Wrestling Federation and a special challenge match. Sting has challenged Black Bart, and we're going to go see just how this challenge comes around.
You know, this might not be real pretty, but there's going to be a whole lot of action because both these men know how to throw that big right hand, and I'm really looking forward to seeing the outcome of this one.
Black Bart, a 300-plus pounder in the stable of General Skandar Akbar, and he perhaps has ignited a fire in Sting, the likes of which we have never seen, because both these men are fighting with all they have here at the outset of this challenge match on the Universal Wrestling Federation.
Well, this is exactly the kind of challenge Black Bart needed, because he's a man who prides himself on his devastating wrestling ability in the ring, and Sting has given him back 100% of that same devastation right here with those big boots to the stomach.
General Akbar here with derogatory remarks as usual. We expect nothing the less from him. But Sting came to the ring full of fire. Black Bart was ready for the fight as well.
Well, I know Akbar is very unhappy because he's having the tables turned on him right here, because this is a man who can get down just as dirty, just as mean, just as nasty as anybody Akbar has ever brought out. And I think Black Bart's definitely got his hands full right now, because Sting has really laid him in.
Plus, he's young. He's in tremendous condition. He is just reaching his potentiality, and he has just floored 300-plus pounds of Black Bart. Bart choking Sting back into the corner. This one here has not been pretty, Magnum.
As I said, I didn't look for anything scientific in the outcome of this match. These men have been having a pure six brawl out here, and they are still right in the heat of battle. Black Bart right there with his hands around the throat of Sting. They're trying to ignore the referee, but they really need to do something to keep this somewhat under control, because this could really just be an all out and out war right here.
Sting with a side headlock into the ropes he goes. Referee goes down, but the referee voted it once, but not the second time. Referee Edward Falky voided the collision one time, but not the second time around. And now, here comes Akbar into the ring. Akbar holding Sting, holding Sting's legs. Are we going to see the Texas Compactor from the top rope? Black Bart poised up there. But there's Chris Adams. Chris Adams pushing Black Bart off the rope.
And that's exactly what we needed, a turnaround right here, because Sting gave Black Bart all the battle he could handle, and they tried to turn it around on him right now, doubling up on Chris Adams. They need to do something to utilize their both these men in the ring so they can turn the odds around in their favor.
Akbar is using his prop, but more importantly, they've got that branding iron. Black Bart once again, but Sting has taken the branding iron away. And you can see what that means to Akbar and Black Bart. They know what a weapon it is.
They know what it is, and Sting definitely wouldn't hesitate to use it right here against Black Bart today.
Following that outstanding feature match of the week here on Pro Wrestling This Week, we move on to our international match. This features Mexican competitors. We're going to watch the giant Alaskan and Pedro Aguayo going up against Jose Lothario and the Fishman.
Se está desquitando con creces. Se está desquitando con creces. Ahí vemos el conteo. Una, dos palmaditas. No se rinde todavía Fishman. La acción continúa con mi compañero Adolfo Pérez.
Gracias, Ernesto. Bueno, aquí estamos viendo nuevamente al perro Aguayo poniendo de plancha al Fishman. Ahí va a subirse a la cuerda superior el perro Aguayo para caerle esas 240 libras en la humanidad. Ahí se mueve el Fishman, amigos. Cayó de espaldas el perro Aguayo. Ahora sí quedó bien Aguayo con ese golpe que se dio en la espalda. Ahí hace lo mismo el Fishman, pero sacó mejores resultados. Ahí el platanito, ref 1, 2. Y entra el Alaskan. Entra el Alaskan a defender a su compañero. Ahí vamos a ver, ahí está el martinete. Parece si lo deja, si lo suelta. Ahí está el martinete, bien aplicado de parte del Fishman. Es un golpe doloroso a la nuca, 1-2. Hace un puente ahí. Levanta los hombros, se levanta el perro aguayo. Y por poco ganan la lucha el Fishman y el gran Lotario. Ahí está el Grand Slam otra vez. Ahí en el entarimado va a ser el Fishman la misma operación que hizo el perro aguayo anteriormente. Ahí va de nuez. Y lo recibe con las rodillas el perro aguayo. Lo recibió con las rodillas. Ahí está doliéndose el Fishman. Se está doliendo. Le pegó las partes blandas del estómago. Vean ustedes, están muy malas condiciones. El Fishman, ahí está un golpe sumamente prohibido, amigos. Ese sí fue prohibido.
Well, Gordon, what a tough way to win a match.
Yeah, really.
Sometimes it bees that way.
It does indeed. Well, I tell you what, let's travel on to Portland, Oregon now, in the home of Northwest Heavyweight Championship Wrestling. We're going to watch the Heavyweight Championship go on the line. Mike Miller finally gets his shot against the crippler Rip Oliver. Now, Art Cruz and Joey Jackson are locked inside a steel cage at ringside. Watch what happens.
Down there right now. Into the ropes goes Miller. He just took an elbow from Rip Oliver. Oliver going for the pin. 1, 2. Oh, that was close. Mike Miller kicked out on the count of about 2.5. Rip Oliver staying right on him. Oh, Miller's eyes are really glassy, though. Into the ropes he goes. And a back body drop by Rip Oliver. And Miller is hurting. This could be it right here. 1, 2, and again, Miller kicks out just in the nick of time. Rip Oliver staying right on him. Here comes a whip. Into the ropes. And both men trying to grab each other, going for a backslide. And it's Mike Miller with a backslide on Rip Oliver. 1, 2, he got him, he's got him! Mike Miller with a backslide on Rip Oliver. Mike Miller with the victory. Mike Miller is the new Pacific Northwest Heavyweight Champion. Sandy Barr has the belt. Rip Oliver has interceded, and Rip Oliver just put Sandy Barr down, and now he just smashed Mike Miller with the belt. Here comes Art Cruz and Joey Jackson. They got out of the cage, and they are, oh, man. Rip Oliver using that belt to smash the head, the face of Mike Miller. And here comes the Wrecking Crew. Yes, sir. We got Billy Two Eagles in there, Steve Dahl's in there, Coco Samoa, Scott Peterson. Sandy Barr is up. He's all right. Well, not only is this going to cost cost Rip Oliver the title, it's going to cost him some money because he attacked the referee. And then all of his hoodlums attacked Mike Miller. Miller's going to be okay, and he is now the champion. Mike Miller, the new Pacific Northwest Heavyweight Champion.
This is a long match, and he's been in for most of it. There's a tremendous right drive to the head by Eric Emery.
Well, of course, we're back from our commercial break. We want to congratulate Mike Miller, the new Pacific Northwest Heavyweight Champion. And speaking of title matches, another one right now.
And that's indeed the world-class tag team championship match between the Fantastics, Eric Embry, and Frankie the Thumper Lancaster. Watch what happens near the end of this match.
Rogers wants to tag Fulton, but he's crawling to the wrong corner. He does not know for sure where he is. He's been in a long time.
Hey, Tommy's been through a pile driver. He's been through everything else. He doesn't know where he is. He just knows to tag Bobby, and he's looking for him. Turnbuckle. Reversal. Beautiful.
Rogers may not be through yet, but just as we say that, the Thumper raises the knee. But they're under the rope. No pin. Oh, there's a stomp to the midsection. Kerry, they are really going at it out there. You can tell the belts are on the line.
And I'll tell you what, the fans are really behind them. Boy, Tom is in trouble. You know, but they want to win the match legally. Bobby's not coming in. He's waiting for that tag. I'll tell you what, it takes a tough man to not do that, not to come in when you see your partner in that kind of trouble. Tommy's got a lot of guts, though, doesn't he?
He really does. This is a long match, and he's been in for most of it. There's a tremendous right drive to the head by Eric Embry. Follows with the headbutt falling here from the turnbuckle. Fulton is in.
He couldn't hold off any longer.
Could not hold off his right. Thumper and Embry have tagged in and out numerous times. Rogers has not been able to get to the cutter. Give the Thumper and Embry credit for that.
Boy, Tommy Rogers is a true champion, isn't he? Look at him. He's fighting back even through everything we've seen him go through. Boy, it's tough sitting here, Mark. I wish I was in that ring.
The weary Rogers grabs the rope, falls down afterward when the Thumper went down. Fulton urging Tommy on to get the tag. So is this crowd.
Thumper's trying to make the tag. He makes the tag. Here comes Embry. Here comes Bobby. Beautiful.
Here comes Fulton, and look at Embry back away. Fulton gets rid of both of them.
Rocking and rolling, huh?
Listen to the crowd ooing on every drive. Head in the
turnbuckle.
Got
another four-way.
All four men involved. Remember, Fulton and Embry are illegal. Here's beautiful boy Tony the Cowboy.
Boy, Tony,
interfering, shoving Eric Embry on top. They're the legal man. One, two, three. Oh, my goodness.
Son of a gun. I'll tell you, the referee can't call what he didn't see, Mark. He did not see what poor Tony did. But hey,
Cowboy Tony's terrible. Interference has taken the World Tag Team belts right out of the hands of the Fantastics. The crowd is a
now head. Just ask yourself, on what other wrestling program would you see two major titles changing hands like you've just seen right here on Pro Wrestling This Week? We're going to take you back now to 1953 to our Mat Classic. It's Tarzan Torville as he goes up against Don Arnold. This one truly a classic.
Whatever's going to happen. Arnold putting a twister on that left wrist of Torville. It hurts, you know, your arm will go around only so far. And the crowd doesn't like this. They think that this is not legal, but it is. Arnold was placing the pressure on the shoulder, and that's perfectly legitimate. Also hitting with an open hand. If Arnold were to let go suddenly now, that arm of Tourville's would untwang like a rubber band. He's got it twisted around pretty well. Arnold may whip him now into the corner. Part of that was that it was given on a break. The jolt was all right, a forearm smash, but he did it on the break. Look out here. We got some action going. Flying drop kick by Tourville. That time Arnold got out of the way. And who wouldn't? There's the Boston Crab hold, but not for long. Tourville showing tremendous leg strength. Now he's back in there in a pinning position. Arnold may have him here. Got a two count. He's got the three count. Beautiful action in there. Fine wrestling on the part of both. Don Arnold gets the win, but not without a great struggle from Tarzan Torville, who appreciates the fact that Arnold is a superb performer.
Well, wrestlers and wrestling fans alike look forward to this segment of our program each week because we name the Wrestler of the Week. And, Joe, this week it's quite a man.
That's right. As a matter of fact, our Wrestler of the Week has 981 reasons for winning that award this week. Congratulations to Doug Furness, truly the strongest man in the world. Let's go back now and take another look at that 981-pound squat that earned him that record and this week's award.
This is 981 pounds.
981.
Has anybody else lifted that much?
No, not in the 75s. I got the world record at 985. This is, I broke the total record this day. And I had to work for it. It was a little harder than I thought it would be.
It was absolutely phenomenal. I've known an awful lot of wrestlers who have claimed to be pretty powerful weightlifters, but I think it's safe to say, in watching that lift, that you are indeed today the world's strongest man.
Well, thank you.
Well, congratulations, of course, Gordon, to Doug Furness. He is this week's Wrestler of the Week.